that big orange ball in the sky. Is it not great? I could deal with a little bit warmer temperatures, but that sun just makes it all okay, right? And now we're actually going to give thanks for the sun that actually makes a big difference in our life. You know, Jesus, who died on the cross for our sins, and he is our way maker. So if y'all stand and sing with me, and Leslie and Abigail and David when he gets here.
Miracle worker, way maker, miracle. working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Amen.
I just wanted to say something real quick. I don't know if my mic's on or not, but it's good to see a lot of people we haven't seen in a while here.
Amen.
It's a blessing to all of us. And I won't hold you up, Kevin, but I won't name names because I'll forget somebody that has showed up. But each one of you are very important to this church. And the church really feels it when you're not here. And I speak for myself. I don't know who you are. You may not think you're a valuable part of this church, but believe me, the church hurts when just one of us doesn't show up or doesn't miss a day.
Well, good morning, family and friends. How are y'all doing this morning? I resonate with David. We've been talking this past week about the body of Christ and how God fashions us together, just like a real physical body. And so God says all the parts need one another. We're interdependent. And when people are missing, it is like walking without your big toe. I don't know if you've ever stubbed your big toe or missed a big toe, but it's a little hard to walk. Or if you miss your left eye or your right arm or your left shoulder, you see what I'm saying? It's just a little harder to operate. We're a little more handicapped, in other words. So we don't want to stay handicapped. We want to be healthy and strong, don't we? So anyway, if you're visiting with us here live or online, we want to welcome you and thank you for joining in. Hope this will be a blessing to you, as I know it will be, as God's for the message on my heart. So we are glad everyone's here. Does anybody here feel like going to Armenia? Not today. Well, our association, led by our beloved David Phelps, Director of Missions, he has been going the last 9 years, and he'll be going again this summer. His daughter and son-in-law are fixing to get ready. I think he gets his PhD from Southeastern Seminary to go over there, and I think he's going to be a professor of the seminary they developed over there. And so they're going to be living over there, and David's been going and helping people come help. So anyway, I encourage you to pray and think about going on a mission trip if you've never been to Armenia. It's in the bulletin today, that the details of that. And David's actually going to come next week and talk a little more about that. So stay tuned to that, the details on that. Also, I was told Mary Tyson said that anybody's looking for a wheelchair or something similar to that. Skateboard or I don't know that.
Scooter.
So, scooter, thank you. Scooter. Skateboard, same thing, right? Anybody need one? She's got one. So she wants to hook you up with that. All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we ask Him to move in our midst. Lord, we just thank you that you've given us another day of life. Today is a gift, and you want us to open up all that's inside, all that you want to reveal to us in our inner life, inside of us.
And so we thank you for being such a loving and gracious and mighty God. We just thank you. We worship you today. We come here fully acknowledging our need for you and our wantonness of you. And we want you to move in us and around us, surround us with your presence and your glory today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you all.
Good to see
you. Yes, it is. Amen. Before we get started, I just want to say thank you for your prayers for Willie and I, John and Wendy, and our family. We really appreciate that. It means a lot. I don't know how people get along without it. Down at the cross where my Savior died, down in the sin I cried. There by my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There in my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast your soul at the Savior's feet. Charge it today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Can you say amen?
Amen.
All right.
Good morning. So this song is called The Promise, and it's about the promises that God made to us. And some that he never promised. Some things he never promised.
Bye.
but I did say I'd always be by your side. And I did say I'll always help you fight. 'Cause you know I've made a promise that I intend to keep. My grace will be sufficient in every time of need. My love will be the anchor that you can hold on to. Turn their backs on you, or that the world around you wouldn't see you as a fool. But I did say, like me, you'll surely be despised. And I did say, my ways confound the wise. Said you'd never taste the bitter kiss of death, or have to walk through chilly Jordan to enter into rest. But I did say I'd be waiting right on the other side. Yeah. And I did say I'll dry every tear you cry. You know I've made a promise that I prepare a place, and someday sooner than you think, you'll see me face to face. And you'll sing with the angels and the countless multitude. This is the promise. This is the promise I've made to you.
So how about it? Are you standing on God's promises this very day? With all that's going on in this world, just think about the promises that He's given us. He's always going to be there right by our side.
So just keep on walking, don't turn to the left or right, and in the midst of darkness, let this be your light. That hell can separate us, I'm gonna make it through. This is the promise. This is the promise I made to you. Oh, this is the promise. This is the promise I made to you.
Thank you, Wendy. Did anybody come here today because of a promise? Anybody here come today banking on a promise or having promises from God? Well, we know if we have accepted Him as our Lord and Savior, He promises us eternal life in heaven with Him when we die. So we praise God for the glorious gospel in Jesus Christ. And for those of you watching, that is the only way, and that is the way that God wants us to take. So pray that anybody would make that decision by the end of their day today if they never have. Well, today is part five of five on this sermon series on bad attitudes, and we have been through a lot of bad attitudes together. 14 of them all together by the end of this day. And I wonder how many of us have experienced all 14 of those bad attitudes at some time or another in our life. You know, somebody's raising their hand. That's right. I have too. I have been through the wilderness through a lot of those. You know, the truth is, if we're honest this morning, haven't we all had a difficult time maintaining a good attitude all the time? Isn't it difficult to maintain a good attitude 24/7? It just is, especially when we're going through seasons of life when it seems like everything's going against us. You ever feel like that? It's kind of like the board game Monopoly. Anybody here play the board game Monopoly? Yeah. Well, you know, when you play Monopoly, I don't know if you've played it enough times, but there just seems to be, there's games where it just, it seems like everything's going your way, and you're gaining all the properties, and there just seems to be nothing that can go wrong. And then there's games where it seems like you spend a lot of time in jail. I mean, a lot of time. And that just seems like you keep getting sent there over and over and over again. Well, we played this game, Monopoly, during our family time this past week. And I can tell you one thing. It was probably the worst game I'd ever played in my life. I kid you not. I went to at least jail 6 times by the 3rd round. And I'm not kidding you when I say this, but I think I actually defied all odds of beating what I believe, since the inventor invented this game, and no man on the face of the earth has ever played as bad a game as I had played. I kid you not, I defied all logical possibilities and odds of what I'm about to share with you. Just hang in there with me. I'm just going to share a few examples of what happened. And my wife can testify that this happened. But, for example, the first roll I had, I landed on my son's property. And so I had to pay him rent because he had rolled and bought the roll before. You see what I'm saying? And that's all happened to us. That's not bad. You know, but that's happened to all of us. You know, not a big deal. But have you ever had one of those days or those games where that happens and you have this sneaky suspicion that, I don't know, just this is not going to go well for me? You ever had one of those days where you have a bad morning and you just, yeah, we all have bad mornings, but there's something deeper. Like there's a premonition. You ever had one of those like, I just really feel this is going to go south and bad, and I got this funny feeling. Well, I want to tell you that when that happens, when you have that feeling or that premonition, I call that the GR2 radar. GR2. Write that down. That's your GR2 radar. That's right. That's a God-given, built-in internal device. It's an internal premonition that basically he's saying, watch your heart. Watch your heart. In other words, watch your attitude, because of what's about ready to happen, it's going to be tested. And you just got to be careful, because you don't want to mishandle things or stay there too long. And so it's vitally important that we protect our heart, because that protects our faith and it protects our walk with God. And that's very important, because the heart and our walk are vitally connected. Well, anyway, my suspicions were confirmed, because after only 3 trips around the board, everybody else had 7 or 8 properties. Guess what I had? I had one. I had massed 1 property, yeah. But it was my least favorite of all of them. Isn't that funny? It's actually my least favorite. It's that utilities property. It might as well be a junkyard card, because that's what it amounts to me. You can't. Hey, I'm sorry if that offends you. We live in a day and age where people are easy to offend. You know, hey, don't be talking about my favorite property on the Monopoly board, right? No, but you can't build. You can't advance. You can't build houses on it, right? You know? And it's only worth, what, 4 times the roll of the die, you know, if you only own one? Anyway, I had rolled a doubles, and, you know, I begin to get hope, because that's usually a good sign, right? You roll doubles. Well, I land on the chance card, and I pull the chance card out, and it said, go back 11 spaces. Well, going back 11 spaces, I actually went back further than where I was when I originally rolled. And I had, how did you know that? I had to pay rent on my son's property again. Now I got water and ice. This is not good. This is, I hope this is not an ominous sign. Oh my goodness. Let me get one more drink. Before you go. All right, this is going to be good. I have a feeling. I got that funny feeling. So I rolled doubles, and, you know, I appreciate it. Anybody want a front row seat here? Because we're going to get another cup, and we're going to do the same thing. No, it'll get on you, right? So I had to pay my son rent. I don't know how you knew that. That was amazing. So I had to pay him rent again. My 12-year-old son, a father should not have to pay his son rent. Anyway. So I rolled doubles, and I land on this chance card, and you don't believe what it said. It said, you got nauseated from eating a bad sack lunch your mom made. Go straight to jail. Now you're saying, what version are you playing? I was playing the Crystal Coast version. I got it at Walmart. Actually has all the local amenities and properties, all the surrounding areas. It's got the Marine Corps Air Station on there. It's got Topsail Island, you know, Atlantic Beach. It's got lighthouses for the railroads. It's got, you know, the aquarium down Pine Knoll Shores. All, you know, all the things you guys know about, right? And so they make these cards. I'll tell you more about that. But anyway, who sends somebody that's sick? Who sends the PD to somebody that needs to go to the ER? Free doctors. You're sick. Anyway, I mean, do you send somebody on their deathbed to death row? You know? I mean, it just doesn't seem right. And so I can tell you for sure, I did not get a fair trial in this game. Anyway, I know that it'll make sense. But anyway, this Monopoly game, it was for the birds. So get this. What made that go to jail card even more comical is on the Crystal Coast version, the cards aren't labeled chance. I just said that so you'd understand and relate. Those cards are labeled a fun thing. A fun thing. Now you tell me, is going to jail a fun thing? That doesn't even make sense. I mean, especially if you just got done eating your mom's bad sack lunch that made you nauseated and you go to jail, that's not a fun thing. Getting nauseated, throwing up is not fun. Going to jail is not, that game, that's just, it's ridiculous. I don't know. If the inventors of that game think that's a fun thing, we live in an even sicker society than I originally imagined and thought we were in. Listen, I'm going to speed this up. I'm going to speed this up to say, I can tell you that every single row was negative. I don't know what the odds are of rolling 20 straight negative rolls, but I'm just going to get to the climax and the peak of this story and to tell you that on the third round, I had one property, my least favorite, you know, and so that should have told me something. But my son, by this point, owned both Parkway and Boardwalk, Park Place and Boardwalk, and because my wife, you know, she traded and gave me one, which is really dumb. Anyway, we ain't going to go into that. Don't tell her that, but she's not here. So the Park Place and Boardwalk equivalents, you know, on this board, my family's hooping and hollering. They're hooping and hollering because I'm coming around the board, and my wife is encouraging, buy houses now, because there's no way he won't land on your property. Nobody rolls 20 straight bad rolls and is going to get scot-free. This is going to happen. It's going to happen. I'm like, I can feel it. And so I get there. I roll. This time, I'm going to try to break the curse. So you know how you do this in Monopoly? Y'all done this, right? So you roll one die this time, right? Y'all done that, right? Because it's going to change your fortune, right? So you roll one die. So I got it. So it came down to some number and a three, basically. And if I got one of those numbers, I would land on his properties. So I like my chances, right? Because on two dice, that's a two-third chance in our favor, right? Right? 67%, 70% are in my favor, right? Only a third is against me, right? Well, guess what? As soon as that top of the die hit three, there was mass hysteria. People were laughing, rolling out. I mean, there was just unbelievable hysteria. I mean, cackling over. I've never seen so much hysterical laughter over the misfortune of one person. I kid you not. And you know what? I actually joined in on the laughter over the absurdity of the astronomical odds that I had attained. There's no way that can even be possible. In fact, I'm going to show you a clip from, y'all seen The Money Pit? Tom Hanks? I was wanting to show the first 3 minutes of this, but for time purposes, I don't have time. But before this happens, what you're about ready to see this scene. He was in the kitchen, you know, and all the electrical circuits are just burning out, toasters blowing up, blenders burning up, and he's had tons of other things happen before this to give you context. But I kid you not, this is how I laughed when I hit Boardwalk. I kid you not, I laughed identical to that. You can ask my wife. I had trouble. I had tears in my eyes. I was laughing so hysterically. I never laughed so hard in years that I couldn't even get out of my mouth saying, there is no way possible that can happen. There's no way. My wife looked at me and said, she stopped her laughing. She goes, are you on drugs? Listen, I say all that to say, listen, when we beat the odds, everyone around us benefits. Amen. Now, I know you guys are thinking, are you talking about bad odds? Yeah. Hang with me. I'm even talking about bad odds. Listen, when you beat the odds, everyone around us benefits. Everyone around us benefits. Even if our odds are, even if we've happened to amass the world's worst possible misfortunes that could ever be aligned for any one person to possibly experience. I mean, people can be won over by Christ by our demonstration of a good attitude, by your faith in Jesus Christ, especially at incredible misfortunes that hit you and they're watching and observing and witnessing. And so many people benefit when we choose not to put on a bad attitude and put on a good attitude because of our faith and despite what's happening. And so when we work on our attitude and we get that higher level of faith and a higher level of attitude, we don't just bless ourselves in getting out of misery, we bless other people by watching. Listen, I'm going to prove to you, just look at the book of Job. If anyone had the worst possible deck handed to them, if anyone had the worst possible, you know, things happen and misfortune in their life, it was Job. And despite his wife urging him to put on a bad attitude and curse God, you know, she had her own bad attitude. And part of that might have been her bad attitude, might have been, by the way, you might not know this, but in Job 19:17, it says that she was repulsed by Job's breath. So we had bad breath too. Anyway, I say all that to say, as a result of Job choosing an attitude that reflected or refrained from losing the integrity of his faith, God chose to preserve this good man's good attitude and have his story recorded through the annals of time so that millions of people around the world like you and me would be able to have this story and inspire us and to show us that he can redeem even our suffering. Isn't that incredible? Listen, millions of Christians, millions of people have been blessed by this man's story for over 4,000 years. You and I are still reading about it today. It's the number one go-to story. What? And we think of what? The patience of Job or the suffering of Job? Isn't that incredible? That's what God is trying to say. Even when the odds of even misfortune, our attitudes can simply change the world. Did you know our attitude can change the world? You can bless generations, not just this generation around you, surrounding you now. You can bless generations in your family and friends and theirs for generations to come, just like Job's. I know that's hard to believe and imagine, but we see all the time. How many people talk about, you know, people in their family line that maybe, you know, was an incredible Christian and demonstrated a great attitude? Those people stand out, don't they? Don't you remember those people more so? Yeah, they are. Okay, so we're going to jump right in. Here's that bad attitude number 13. Bad attitude number 13. I'm deprived attitude. You all know what that's about, right? All right, look, I'm going to read to you the text here in Numbers 20, 1 through 5 here together. It says, the first month, the whole Israelite community arrived at the desert of Zin, and they stayed at Kadesh, some called Kadesh Barnea. There, Miriam died and was buried. Now, Miriam, you know, is the older sister of Moses, and she's been through a lot with him, and she was the one that, you know, was partially responsible for rescuing him in water of all places, the Nile, and so now he's seen her life come and go and pass. And so it's important that we see this here. And so she's passed, Miriam. And I want to show you this map where we are here on Kadesh. If we can go to the map before we go further. Do we have that radar, that laser? Not radar. I don't know why I said that. Laser. The show on the upper right, Kadesh Barnea. There we go. He's hit it right there. That's a jackpot right there. Kadesh Barnea. That's where they are. They're getting closer to the land of Canaan. So they're hanging around there. And so that's where the community is at. And so we'll read verse 2 here. What's happening here in this location is, it says in verse 2, now there was no water. We got lots of water here today. There was no water for the community, and the people gathered in opposition to Moses and Aaron. They quarreled with Moses and said, if only we had died when our brothers fell dead before the Lord. Why did you bring the Lord's community into this wilderness that we and our livestock should die here? Why did you bring us up out of Egypt, you know, in the first place? you know, to this terrible place. It has no grain or figs, grapevines or pomegranates, and there is no water to drink. Why did you bring us? Whoops, I'm going on. Is that it? Are we out? Okay. Yeah, thank you. So, see, they're out of water. And how many times we've gone through this series, they've complained about water. Y'all remember by this point? Four times. That's right, four times. Remember the first time in Exodus 14:12, they complained about too much water when they faced the Red Sea, right? That was too much water. You might not think of that as a complaint of water, but it was. And they said the same thing. We might as well left us in Egypt. You should have left us die, you know? Exodus 15:22-24, the second incident with not having water was at Marah when they found bitter water. In Exodus 17:1-4, at Rephidim, they complained they had no water. And now here in Numbers 20, they're at Meribah near Kadesh Barnea. And so it's the fourth time they've complained about this same attitude. And so God's, you know, growing tired of this. You know, I don't know about you, but if your kids constantly complain about the same thing and whine, doesn't that kind of get under your skin or kind of eat you away? So we can relate to God, and he can with us and saying, you know, we should get one another when that happens. And so we need to see when our children do that, we're doing, he's feeling the same thing when we do that. Does that make sense? He's hearing and feeling what we feel in here when our children do that. It's the same thing, so we got to remember that. And so also, when we demonstrate a bad attitude, we're demonstrating a low level, an immature, more type of faith. And so I like what one of our members said to me last week, actually as a leader here at our church. She said to me, your message, man, she said it was spot on. She goes, basically, I'll give you a synopsis for what you preached. I said, okay, sure, do tell. She said, in other words, what you're saying is we got to show up to grow up. I was like, wow, I need to have you fill in the pulpit next week because that was pretty good. And it's true. You know, in other words, a deprived attitude is actually a reflection of a depraved attitude. And depraved means, you know, corrupt. We're corrupting what God is trying to do and work in us. And so when we're deprived, y'all know anybody that feels deprived all the time? Deprived. So they feel robbed. They feel shortchanged, that our needs are, being withheld unnecessarily. It's actually a direct judgment on God. It's saying, you know, this is not necessary. You have all the power. You can prevent this. You can intervene. You're not. And I'm entitled, which is rooted in pride and unbelief and ignorance. And what you're doing is you're focusing on what you don't have instead of what you do have. That's the problem. And that takes away from gratitude. It takes away from your thankfulness or your worship of God. In other words, it's a scarcity mindset. You ever heard that, a scarcity mindset? So we have to replace this scarcity mindset with an abundance mindset, because that's actually what we have in Christ today. We are so full of benefits that there's no lack in Christ. And I'm going to explain that to you in just a minute. But did you know that people that have this scarcity or deprivation attitude, they actually cause them to do illogical and irrational things? And that's why it explains a lot of this continuation of these Israelites, of this bad patterning, bad habit of having a bad attitude all the time. In fact, three studies came out. One study showed 500 people found that those who were made to feel poor, they actually put them in a room or whatever, and they made them feel poor. I don't know how they did that. I don't know how it makes me feel poor. But they did that, I guess, successfully. Made them feel poor. And did you know that they ate around 20% more in calories than the other participants? So it just makes us cause, you know, to want more things. Psychology Today says they have an article entitled "Feeling Deprived Can Make Your IQ Drop." Did you know that? In fact, they have a study that showed that they had a 13-point IQ drop in these patients, and it can lead us to irrational and illogical behavior. I'm going to read a quote here from Psychology Today. "New theories and research about the psychology of scarcity provide some insights into how perceiving scarcity negatively impacts our brains and behavior. Emotional deprivation can start in childhood. This feeling of not being important enough or lovable enough can persist into adulthood. And it can develop into a deprivation mindset. If we often feel as if we've never had enough of the things we need, then this sense of insecurity can harm our relationships." In other words, we can develop into a toxic personality and not even realize it. In other words, I put this quote as I was doing this, and the Lord was sharing some things. I put this, four words: scarcity scares off people. If you have this perception that you're without or you're lacking, and you're, you know, kind of a self-pity, whining, moaning, groaning, you know, attitude all the time, it goes on and it says that there's actually a disorder called emotional deprivation disorder. Did you know that? That's not ADD, that's EDD. Emotional deprivation disorder. It was once called deprivation neurosis. It's characterized by difficulty in forming relationships with others, a general feeling of inadequacy, and get this, and an oversensitivity to criticism of others. You can develop an oversensitivity of criticism to others. Listen, do we live in a day and age when people are more sensitive than ever before and easily offended? It stems from that scarcity, that mindset, scarcity mindset. We're deprived. We don't have enough. Man, America lives in abundance. How did we develop that? It's because we became less spiritual. Folks, in America, that's what's happened. How can a country have so much feel so little? It's like we lack so much. It's because we've gone away from God. We've gone off track from Christ. We're not following in Him and His ways. And so we need to understand who we really are in Christ and what we really have in Christ so that we don't go into these false beliefs and that we stay connected so that we can be functional, not dysfunctional and disconnected like so much of the world is, because we have that more and more in our families. Do we not have that? We have more dysfunction in our families than ever before, more broken families, more disconnection than ever before. And people are feeling empty. And it's causing problems. The offices for counseling are waiting lines. Here in this area, you even know. I was telling somebody this past week, what I want our church to get back to is the basics on learning how to love well again. We've lost the art of loving well. People do not know how to have loving, healthy, wholesome relationships anymore. We have to go back to a grassroots movement of really sitting down and getting into small groups and getting together and sharing our lives in such a way that we're not so fearful of flaws of others, because we all have it. At some point, your idiosyncrasies are going to irritate the other person. We have to learn to work through that. We have to learn to be so secure in ourselves that we can receive, you know, when somebody says, hey, you ever thought about maybe handling it this way or that way and not be offended and walk away from relationships and isolate, right, on an island, that we understand we can be stronger together, we can work through things together, and we'll be stronger together as a church of Jesus Christ. Amen? Listen, the Israelites had this scarcity mindset. We see it all the time. Most of their complaints centered on food, did it not? Food, where's the water? Where's the food? We're still concentrating on getting to the restaurant after church and not even listening to the message. That's not you guys. I'm not saying that is. I'm just saying people do that. Do they not do that? Man, what time is it? I got, Golden Corral's got a special. Man, anyway, listen, I got a quote here from an article that says an obsession and hyperfocus over these things that are not as important as the real things, they create a tunnel vision and they cause us to choose over and over again a failing attitude, a failing response. We actually are more tempted to do wrong things when we feel deprived. Did you know that? So your temptation level rises, right? You ever heard of the acronym HALT? You see, pay attention to HALT, those four letters. You know, when you're hungry, you're more susceptible to temptation. When you're angry, you're more susceptible to temptation, right? When you're lonely, you're more susceptible to temptation, right? I don't know what the other one is. Anyway, tired or something, I'll ask David Phelps later. Listen, Matthew 6:25-26 says this, therefore I tell you, this is Jesus saying, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, because that's what they're doing there, right? Or about your body, or what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them all and every day. Are you not more valuable than they? So if God can take care of the little birds and you're more important than them, why wouldn't he provide for you? There's no scarcity. There's no lack in heaven. Listen, we need to replace this mindset with realization that in Christ, we lack nothing. There's no shortage. There's no shortages in the resources of heaven above today. Do you know that? There's no shortage in heaven. And you have divine access. We can tap into the spiritual sphere and we can eat and take of this endless supply. Listen, I'm telling you today, if you are in Christ, you have an endless supply of this abundant life when you are feeling empty. I'm going to go through the alphabet here. I got the A through the Z on all that we have in heaven just to prove to you. Listen, God is offering you abundant life for those today who feel empty. He offers countless blessings, blessings to those who seek him. There are unlimited comfort to those who are grieving. See, comfort. He offers endless direction for all your next steps. He has available and is waiting to give eternal life for those who are lost. He offers to be a father to the fatherless, a friend to the friendless forever, and will be faithful to that task and that role. Listen, there's an endless, bottomless cup to the grace he offers us each day when we sin. There's healing for those who are hurting here today and fresh off a broken relationship. H. Listen, there's available today tons of intimacy. Intimacy for those who want more in a relationship. There's J, there's joy to those who have lost it or can no longer find it or are running short of it. There's K, there's kindness to those who have been abused, beaten down, or weary of heart. Listen, there is someone to L, lean on, who has an endless and loving shoulder that we can press into, and he can bless our mess and lessen our stress. And listen, he's able to bound and do miracles to those who are in a sinful stronghold or those whose lives are stuck in the mud. He is the way maker. He is the miracle maker. Listen, he offers fresh and countless new morning mercies to those who are having trouble starting their day, to all who today want to know if there is actually anybody that cares in heaven above. I want you to know that there's openings even. Oh, there's openings for new jobs in the kingdom of living for him and for those who truly want to go after God and want to serve him. And those who are looking for an open door, when all doors seem to be closed, he has an open door for you if you're willing to walk through. Listen, P, he gives and offers perspective on your situation. And I had to add the other P. He wants to give you purpose to when you're struggling with the meaning to life question and when you feel like life is futile. There's quietness for the perplexed soul. And anyone struggling with anger, he wants you to know he can calm your enraged heart with a calmness that his tender hand has to offer that has calmed tons of great many seas over the ages. Listen, he offers refuge to those who are feeling scared or scarred. There's salvation for those in need of forgiveness and assurance of heaven when you die, if you're lacking or wanting to know if you're really going to have that. There's T, truth in a diseased media culture that thrives off lies and false narratives. There's truth. You come here, do you want truth? God offers endless truth. He wants to give truth. Listen, there is there's unconditional love all the time that he has available to anyone who needs it and wants to feel it today. Listen, there's victory for those who feel like they're losing out in life and losing in life. He's extremely patient with those who feel slow, hard on themselves, can't forgive themselves, and offers you extraordinarily and extravagant grace. He offers infinite wisdom for the countless decisions and excruciating difficulties that you're going to face. And he promises to give you generously and liberally to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you if only you ask and believe, James 1:5. And he finally, listen, he is the way maker for W as well. Listen, he offers power to the weak, and he offers zeal to those who have lost their passion and in their step. He wants to give pep in your step and fire to your tire. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He is the one and the only one who sits on the only throne that is indispensable in dispensing the endless needs for every human soul, every man, woman, and child that's ever existed across time, because he is the most benevolent being there has ever been, and who is and who was and is still the one to come in all his radiant power and glory, which is coming shortly around the corner. Are you ready, church? Listen, Psalm 37:25 says, I've never seen the righteous abandoned or their children begging for bread. And that's why God encourages us today and tells us in James 1:4, he says to press on and to endure hardship and trials, because it's when endurance is fully developed, that's when we realize we actually lack nothing. Go back and look at that verse, James 1:4, because it says that. That's when we realize we lack nothing and can develop to that kind of stratosphere. Listen, there's no scarcity in heaven today. For our needs. He's willing to give. Are you willing to receive? Listen, there has never been and never will be. So let's stop being deceived like those Israelites in the desert and realize we were made for the promised land and promised land living. Listen, the sandy desert, it was just meant to chisel off and refine us all those parts in Egypt that we brought with us and brought into this world. We inherited from the baggage of our parents and all the other things from the environment we grew up on, watching TV and all the people we hung around. God's trying to extract that, extricate it. He's trying to remove it. He wants us to be more Christ-like so that we can live more free and have more fun and be more liberally free in Christ. So we need to shed it, lose it, so we can run free. Listen, all that he has to offer should cause us to have a good attitude. It should. But you have to believe it, that he has to offer it. That's the key. That's the connection. And James tells us that. Listen, if you are a believer in Christ Jesus today, you are on a journey with God. Do you realize that? You're on a journey with God. And you are under the leadership of a Moses leader. And I don't like saying that, but in a sense, churches all have a leader. And I never want to even compare myself to Moses, because I'm not. But in a sense, I'm just saying we need to be in church to be under leadership, authority that God's put there to grow with the church, to grow and walk with them if you want to be close to God on that journey. That's the key there. And last week we talked about that, so I don't want to beat that dead horse. But there's a timeline for you and I in this discipleship process. In other words, there are certain expectations and principles he wants you to learn and have down and be implemented into your lifestyle so that you can move on in your life of faith and with the group. In other words, show that map again, John, if you could, of where we're at in this Exodus route. You see, by this time in the story, we're where? At Kadesh Barnea here, about ready to enter the promised land. But some of us are back at Phi, Haharoth, right there. You know that we haven't even crossed the Red Sea. We've not even been baptized into the Sea of Moses, if you will. There's a connection there in the Old Testament, by the way, of foreshadowing to being baptized into Christ that they got to experience by going through the Red Sea. We don't have time for that. But I'm saying some of us are back there because we've never been baptized even. I mean, literally baptized. Or we've never joined a church. And so we're lagging behind in the step of faith. Do you understand how this is a parallel here? You see where I'm going with this? Some of us are lagging behind there. Some of us are still at Mara down the road. We're still back here where everybody else is up at Kadesh. Because, you know, we still don't believe that going to church, that's just the bare minimal, right? We have to move on. That God wants us to move towards Mount Sinai, where some of us still haven't been to Mount Sinai, where the delivery of the word was given through the Ten Commandments. That God wants us to know that we need to be in a discipleship group. If we're not able to be discipled on our own, that's why God offers things like Bible studies on Wednesday night or Sunday school on Sunday mornings. He's saying, listen, that's the opportunity I've been given to you. Because if you're having trouble developing that, and even if you have it down, he still wants to be a part of that in some way so that you can trek together as a church and we're stronger together. And if we're to be a true disciple of Jesus Christ, we have to be able and willing to go through these different campsites and parts along the journey. Does that make sense? Listen, Joshua 1:8 says, keep this book of law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night. That's having your daily devotion in the word. So that you may be careful to do everything written in it. You can't do it if you don't know it, right? And that's just half the battle. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Hebrews 5:12 says, here's where I'm going with the whole thing. Hebrews 5:12 says this. I'll slow down a little bit. My wife says, you get racy sometimes and then people don't understand you. All right. Hebrews 5:12 says this. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you're not even ready. You need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. In other words, they need to go and reboot. They need to go and recamp. They get to do basic training all over. Because somewhere in the past they learned them, but they forgot them because they're not doing them. If you're not doing them, even if you have them in your head, they can be not in your heart, and you're not going to do them. Does that make sense? And so we have to have somebody teach us all over again in the sense how to do them, not just know them. So you still need milk, and you're not ready for more solid food. In other words, you're not ready to go deeper with God. You're not ready for more deeper truths and understanding that he wants to take you to. And that leads us to number 14, our last attitude here. And this one's going to go quick before we close. This is a resentful attitude. A resentful attitude. I'm not going to show you the scripture, John, because I gave the wrong one to you. And so I caught that before I got up here. And so in Numbers 21, chapter 21, here's what happened here. They're at Mount Hor, H-O-R. And so it says here that the people spoke against God and against Moses. They're complaining again. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? Man, how many times are they going to say that? Are you guys getting tired of it? Are you getting tired of the Israelites back then? I mean, that's like a rerun that's just, we just need to turn off that channel. Listen, it says, for there is no food, no water, again, and our soul is getting thirsty. You know, Lowe's this worthless bread. Ooh. It's like take your heavenly man of God and shove it, right? We're getting tired of what you're providing. So the Lord sent, here's what the Lord does. The Lord sent fiery serpents among the people. You know, like one of my worst nightmares is to be thrown down in a basement full of snakes everywhere because you know you're bound to get bitten. And so the Lord sent these fiery serpents. And I don't know why fiery. I don't know if that means they also not only bit, but they blew out fire. I don't know. That's a bad combination, right? Have fire breathe out of you? I don't know. I'm going too far here. Anyway, so among the people, they bit the people, and many of the people of Israel died. And so God told Moses to make a fiery serpent, you know, out of bronze, make it on a pole, and it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live. So he's a God of still second chances. Even at this point, after all that's happened, he's still a God that is full of mercy and wants people to turn back to him and get things right and get things nailed down. God gives so many chances, does he not? And we serve a God who has saved cannibals, who has saved murderers on death row. I mean, God is incredibly compassionate, folks. He wants us. He wants us to get turned around. He wants us to be on right track. He wants us to be a church of the living God. He wants us. He wants us. He really wants to help us. Listen, so it's here that he gives this final solution. I say all this to say, as we close here, there's too many hurting people out there, folks. We don't want to miss this. There's too many hurting people out there to miss this. There's too many hurting people that need our help, that need us to show them how it's done, how it's to be lived out, to bring them in and to disciple them, that they're a hurting mess out there. You know, in 1967, a song came out. It was put out by the group, anybody heard of Jefferson Airplane? Somebody to Love? Go back and listen to that song. Do you know he wrote that song, the writer wrote that song? The original writer wrote that song, and then Jefferson Airplane took off with it. And then, but the original writer that was birthed after his girlfriend left him during that free love era, where he felt that was a dead end, that free love. And he wanted to write a song. Get this. He wanted to write that song. This is the background of this song. He wanted to write a song that would champion loyalty and monogamy. And he did not believe in other songs that toted you can fall in love, as if it's beyond your control, it's just going to happen, it's going to take you away. No, he believed that falling in love is a choice. After you know, and it's in other words, it's an intentional commitment. God wants us as a church to love one another, to make an intentional commitment that we invest, because you're investing in one another. You're investing in eternal things. You're investing in lost people that are hurting. Listen, there's too many people out there that I believe God is saying, don't you want somebody to love? Don't you want somebody to love? You better find somebody to love. He wants us to find somebody to love. So I'm saying here at the end, let's do this right. Let's go find somebody to love today. Close with me, a word of prayer. God, we come here at the end of this hour as a body of believers, seeking you and your vision for us individually as well as corporately. Father, we have so many people out there that they don't know how to love and they don't know where love is, and we do. We have found it. And God, we just ask that you would forgive us of all the countless times and the countless ways we've been short-sighted and self-centered. And we need your help. We need your help to, as a surgeon, to cut off the things of Egypt that are dragging us behind and causing us to fall behind in the trek. And there's so many people that, Father, just need to hear the gospel. And that they would receive it if we went out and get it. Lord, I got my hair cut yesterday and wasn't able to talk to anybody, but we started talking, and then I learned from her, she lives down the neighborhood from me, and she said she's struggling with her neighbors who are on drugs, and that she had to rescue their 2-year-old that was drowning in a pool. When we go out and about in life, we seem to think people are all okay. We don't know what's going on below the surface, Lord, but you do. And in order for us to reach people, we've got to go further below the surface in our walk with you. So help us to be people of depth. And if there's anyone here that's never received you, may they do so and say, Lord, I'm ready to receive you. I want new life. I want a different life. One that's different than the one I've been living. Because, Lord, there's people out there that are feeling that. We pray as we sing this last song that we would commit our heart and our lives to you and to the church and to do all that we were meant to do in serving and using all our gifts, spiritual gifts, our natural talents and wonderful abilities that you gave us, not to just use for ourselves. But we sing, when we sing that others would feel your heart and your spirit in that song, and that they would be reached for you. So may people be reached through this last song. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me.
Many folks here that haven't been in a while, Lord, that's a blessing from you. Lord, we thank you so much for our church. The church is the people, Lord, not the building. Lord, we just pray that you use each one of us and guide us and strengthen us to be an effective member of your body, Lord, of your will. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, the COVID has caused us to not meet together as a body, and Lord, for good reason. We don't want anyone to get hurt. But dear Lord, there is a balance there, and there's an obligation we have to each other and to you. And Lord, help us to seek your will in being the church, to reaching out to the community. Dear Lord, if we have to be restricted by COVID or some other disease that's worse, Lord, we are still the church. And help us to pick up the phone and call our neighbor, call our church members. If we can use internet or Facebook, whatever, Lord, we are still the church, and we can come up with ways that you have allowed us to. Lord, technology can be a gift for you. And like anything, we can use it for good or we can use it for bad. But help us to use it according to your will. Lord, we are so blessed, as Pastor Kevin said this morning, it's easy for us to complain. Lord, if we lose the air conditioning or if we, lose the heat pump or something, Lord, we think the world has come to an end. Lord, but it is not. And you are faithful and you provide for us. And Lord, you have provided for our eternal salvation, which is more important than any physical thing here on this earth. More important than our own health, in fact, Lord. Lord, encourage each person to know that they are a part of your church and that they are important, and that when they don't participate, they're not only hurting the body, they're hurting themselves. Thank you, Lord. Go with us as we go out into our daily lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.